name is Mike, and I'm actually at the old Joliet Prison tonight for a paranormal tour. So join me if you like, and let's see if we can find some ghosts.
In the prison, so thank you for coming out.
Hi, my name is Sean. I'm a paranormal investigator. I've been doing it for 15 years. The name of my group is called IPRA Strong, also known as the Illinois Paranormal Research Association. We have a YouTube channel called Believe, a Paranormal Experience, that you guys can check out. We have a ton of episodes up there, and we also have a few investigations already here up on the channel that you guys can scope out too.
Hi, I'm Leslie. I'm your other paranormal investigator slash tour guide. I am not a part of IPRA, but since being, you know, we are a couple, so we do our own things on the side, and we're just glad to be able to be a part of this here. It's history in the making, for sure. And, I tell everyone, every single night, it's a very, very extremely active place. There hasn't been one night yet that we haven't gotten something solid. So just to warn you too, people have been, had reports of people, you know, something touching them, grabbing on them, pulling purses, bags. So if you do feel that, please feel free to notify one of us, and maybe we can do a little bit further of an investigation to find out if there's anything that is present with us at that moment in time.
I am Shannon, also paranormal investigator for the last 10 years, also tour guide. Welcome to Joliet. It's a privilege to be here.
Now, my name is Earl Gundelak. I hang around Denise a lot. I'm kind of like a ghost. I follow her wherever she goes.
Except when I lost
you. Yeah, just a minute. Well, we found out that the last two people who are on our way, they got a little lost, so they are making their way with us shortly.
Catch up
with us? Yeah, they're going to catch
Perfect.
Up with us.
All right, well, let's start walking.
We have Beth. Beth,
come on over here. Hi.
Beth is our work museum guide.
Yes. Hi.
She's going to make sure that everybody stays safe.
After they built the bigger one, this turned into solitary and death row on the second floor. Solitary was on the first, death row was on the second. This building, nice active, nice activity.
Are we going in there?
Yes, we are.
How many cells?
Yes.
One of the reasons that there's so much energy here is partially why they picked this spot. We've got a lot of limestone underneath us. They actually quarried it on site and built some of the buildings with it. We have the natural water source. We have tunnels that run underneath us. And so that's another way that we get good energy flow from that water. And we also have, with the limestone buildings, you know, it's a natural stone. And it is said, if you know of the stone tape theory, that it absorbs energy and later can play things back. And so that's another reason that we get some good stuff here. One of the other things that helps out a lot is that if you think about it, and I know a lot of times people are like, why would anyone ever stay in a prison? If I, you know, was dead, I would move on. Or go somewhere else or whatever. But you have to remember that there's so much energy and so much emotion all caught up in these buildings and their lives that were spent here. And they didn't know where they were going. And so that fear sometimes kept them here. You know, if I don't know what I move on to, I might not want to move on. So that's another reason they might hang around here. So to give you a history of the prison itself, Dorothea Dix was an advocate, and she had gone to what was then the state prison in Alton. And so when she was there, she was shocked at how deplorable the situation was. And she said, no human should have to live like that. So the state got to work on building a new prison. And so what they did was they came up with this spot because of its natural water, its limestone, and it had, you know, good qualities, and they thought this would be a good place for it. So when they started to build it, they sent 33 prisoners from Alton, from that first prison, up here to build this prison. They started with the building right here. That was the first one they built. And then they moved on from that and built the rest of the prison around them. Now, it was actually a privilege to come up and build your own building. And apparently, you know, we would think, like, I wouldn't do a very good job because why would I want to do that? But it's still standing. So obviously, they took pride in their work and they did a very good job. So that's how we started here. The rest of the 58 moved up here once the prison had been finished. They built the admin building and then the walls around it. And then this building, which was the original, then became solitaire. And then the general cells are on the east and the west side of the admin building. So that was our first prison here. One of the things that I can tell you is that what happened was, after a while, we started getting overcrowded. At some points in time, this was the largest prison, and they decided that we were overrun, and they decided to build Stateville. But Stateville was built in 1925, and the plan was to close down this prison because it was outdated and had lots of people, and they were all going to be sent to the new prison. That actually didn't happen because it was the Depression era. They had Prohibition, the rise in crime, and so they ended up running both prisons. And this prison ended up staying open until 2002. And one of the things I can tell you is that in 2002, they just basically up and left. There was no real plan there. They just sort of one day didn't come back to work. So you're going to see lots of things that are just sort of laying around. When we went through the burn district over there, you could see there were still computers and all kinds of stuff just left there. What I can't tell you about the burn district when we first came in on the side over there, unfortunately, since the prison has been closed, there's been a lot of damage. Part of it is due to the weather and the elements that are getting into these buildings. And then the other part of it is due to humans, and they've done the most damage here. So people kept breaking in. They kept spraying graffiti. There were over 300 things of graffiti already taken down, but you're still going to see quite a bit around here. The other thing with the burn district, people came in, started fires. There were two arson fires that did the most damage on those two main buildings there. That second building there is actually where they made mattresses and whatnot. And so what there is right now, there's an artist initiative. They come in and they scavenged whatever they could take out of there, glass, metal, whatever things they had.
Shells, barbed wire.
Yeah, anything they can find. And they're making artwork out of it, and they're going to sell that, and the proceeds are going to come back to the prison for restoration.
So we can do more tours and more buildings.
Exactly.
Yay!
But we do have to preserve what we've already got going on. And I know we talked a little bit about safety, but there's lots of buildings here that have things that are just not good for us. They're either, you know, crumbling. Some of them, the ceilings are coming down. Some of them can't bear the weight. Some of them have asbestos and other unfriendly things, lead paint, mold. So we will let you in the buildings that are safe to be in. And then some of those other ones we're going to stay away from. Okay, so we're gonna swing around to the front and look at the admin building. I'll tell you another story or two over there, and then we'll head this way for right now. Do get a lot of activity from it, even from the parking lot side. People have seen black shadows go past the windows, but there's no one in that building, and I'll tell you why. Because the fourth floor is coming down onto the third floor, which is coming down to the second floor, so there's no people actually in that building, and it is starting to fall down, so you have to be careful of it, so we can't actually go inside. But just watching from the outside, we've caught a lot of stuff, so keep a good look at it. In that building, which, like I said, is the admin building, the first floor had the warden's office on it. The second floor and the third had the warden's apartments, because it was a law for a very long time that the warden or a sheriff or whoever had to live with the prisoners, and so their families would live here. That was fairly common. Actually, the builder who was here, now our architect is William Boyington, and he actually did the Water Tower in Chicago and the Gates of Rose Hill Cemetery, so we have that lovely fortress-like look. Which you can kind of recognize in the towers over there. But the builder was Lorenzo Sanger, and he actually lived here and built a house on the grounds, and his family actually lived here with him. Even after the prison was done, his family stayed here for quite a few years. Now, that's not something we would ever do today, but it was fairly common to have people just around. But we mentioned the women before. I don't know if everybody heard that story, but on the fourth floor is where they kept the women. When they first opened the prison, women were just mixed in with the men, and that didn't actually go very well for them. I know that's shocking. So they decided to take all the women. They put them up on the fourth floor. They were only allowed out one time a year, and that was 4th of July, and then they could go to what was then a pond where the cistern is. But unfortunately, like I said, they were up there all the time. They were allowed to keep their children with them up until age 5. Now at age 5, they either had to go to a family member or to the town orphanage. So not a very friendly existence. But what they did was, in 1896, they decided to build a women's prison. And that's the one across the street. It's sort of a baby version of this prison. It does have 100 cells, and it did run until 1933. In 1933, they built another prison in Dwight, the Women's Correctional Facility, which is where it is now. That building then became like a processing center. People would bring their, police departments would bring their prisoners in, and they would be processed out whether they were coming here or headed to a different prison somewhere else. So that's what they used that for. But there were tunnels that went under across the street to there and to the quarry and whatnot, even the ones to the guard towers, but they're all flooded now. So we do have a lot of water underneath us. Of all the prison deaths that took place here, I know someone had asked a little bit about that. We probably the most, although they've had some guards killed and definitely some inmates, probably the most famous murder here was in 1915. And what had happened was Warden Allen was very well known for prison reform. And so he had been at a conference in New Orleans. He had met a woman named Odette Bordeaux, and she was a famous singer down in New Orleans. And so he met her and fell in love. They went ahead, got married. She moved back up here with him. The town absolutely adored her. They called her the Angel of Joliet. She...
the little mother of the big stir as well.
Yeah. The prisoners also loved her. She sang for them too, and they just absolutely adored her. Ned was known for prison reform at the time, what they referred to as like an honor system. And so at that time they had people, like they had an honor farm where prisoners would go out and they would grow all the crops and bring it in. They were sort of self-sustaining in here. They also had shops and stuff that they ran that people from town would come in and buy things. At that point in time in prison reform, the push was to give you a set of skills and then send you back out. So if I gave you something, some kind of, you know, skill set to use, maybe you wouldn't end up back in prison. But it was more like a family. They were very close, and it was sort of set up like a community. But they were also, they also had some freedom, which we would never think of in prison now. but it was, again, like I mentioned, people lived here with their families. It was a different era. So basically what happened was Warden Allen was going to present his wife with a very expensive ring. And so he was going to throw a party for her outside of town. But her dressmaker did not finish her dress, and she called him and said, "I'm not coming." So what she ended up doing, she stayed here the night before. She had gone to the movies with his children. She came back. They had three men who they referred to them as houseboys. And so it was their job to take care of the family. And of those three men, one of them was Joe Campbell. And so his nickname was Chicken Joe. I don't know why. But he was the one helping her that day. So at 5:30 in the morning, he comes into the house. He gives her her coffee and her newspaper. She tells him to take the dog out, so he does. At 6:30, they see smoke coming out of the building. The fire department rushes in. They find that the fire is contained to her bed. And unfortunately, Odette has been bludgeoned, probably assaulted, and set on fire. And unfortunately, the prison is in an uproar. They've decided it's Chicken Joe. They took the three houseboys and locked them into solitary, more for their own safekeeping, because they really were going to lynch him right there on the spot. And poor Warden Allen has just lost his wife, and he has to say, you know, I want justice as much as anyone else, but we can't just blame this guy. We don't have any proof that he actually did it. But unfortunately, they decided he should be put to death. The governor stepped in and said, you know, you can't rush to judgment. So instead, he commuted his sentence to life in prison. And Chicken Joe lived here until 1950 when he passed away, even though really no good evidence that he was the one who did it. Odette is buried in Oakwood Cemetery. And the day of her funeral, the whole town shut down. Everyone went to her funeral. They said there were four truckloads of flowers delivered to her grave that day. So the town was very upset, as well as the prisoners.
One of those those things also for Chicken Joe is that he, the reason why it's shrouded in mystery as to whether or not he did it or not, he only had a short period of time before he was going to be released. I think, what,
He had five more days left.
Five more days. So what would be the point of him doing this at that?
Or at least not to do that.
There was a man that was murdered, not just murdered in that stairway, but when they had found him, his body parts were, he was completely dismembered, body parts throughout the whole entire stairwell, so.
You got that spirit box?
I do. So I'm going to go ahead and turn on a spirit box here. I'll do a couple questions you guys can know about and see if you get anything.
Hey, American spirit box.
No.
Oh, dude, I want to get out.
Okay, spirit box, it rapidly scans through AM and FM radio stations, and you can set a speed to it. And when spirits can actually use that box to be able to communicate with us. They can either use the words from the radio stations itself to be able to speak with us, or if it's a spirit that has more higher energy to it, more strength to it, it can actually use its own words over the spirit box, over the voices of the radio, which we have had that happen plenty of times. And a lot of people ask us, how do we know that this is real? Well, I'm going to explain to you why this is real. The FCC does not allow anyone to use any kind of profanity. And we have a little child here, so I will not say some of these words. So you will hear these words being said.
She'll teach you a few.
So, and we have been called some pretty brutal things, even out by our names as well.
Are you touching me? All right, so I can ask a couple questions.
Is anybody here right now with us?
Aristotle. I hope he's not here with us.
How many spirits are in this room with us right now? Can you please tell us?
Six.
One.
If you said six, say it again.
You were in here right now that were wrongfully convicted.
White racist.
White racist.
Wow. That's no bullshit.
First. 15. The genius of
how much time do you have on this stuff?
Is there any way we can communicate with the spirit of the man who was found dismembered in the hallway going up to death row? Are you here?
Spirits, can you come talk to me through this device? Can you say happy birthday to this little girl?
Are the White Sox going to win the World Series this year?
Do you want to ask your question?
How about that? How
old are you?
That's going to be the homework.
You're running your social hand.
Did you hear 11?
I heard 11.
Yeah.
Are you 11?
Try again, guys.
Go on!
With gifts.
Give her gifts.
Wow.
You hear that? She deserves a birthday cake, don't she?
You know what's funny about that? Actually, we'll offer to send her a birthday present.
for the tour being canceled and our bus downtown.
Oh, wow.
Oh, nice day.
1999. Can you say hello to everyone that's in here with us? I'm sure we have some non-believers here and want some proof that you're here. Can you say something to them?
All right, guys. We're going to say goodbye for now.
Please.
Wow.
So prior to you guys coming in here, we have had pretty good communication on here. A couple of you guys were already in here and heard it yourselves.
My meter's going off.
So this here is actually known as it's the dentist office of the building. We do have a few spirits that we have been able to. So we do have a few different spirits that we have been able to communicate with that we actually can say we kind of know pretty well. We have one that that roams around here that we call Half Naked Greg. And I wasn't here for that session. Colleen was, and a couple other people, and they were trying to communicate with him. They asked him what his name was. They said his name was Greg. They and somehow it got brought up about what he was wearing, and come to find out, he was only wearing socks.
We think he came from the third floor.
Yeah, the third floor is actually was the insane asylum to this place, and they only got paper gowns. So as you, I don't think those paper gowns are really going to last for too long, and I'm pretty sure quite a few times they probably did have naked people running around here. So we actually have a dousing rods that we do, and Greg has been pretty active for us in moving these rods. Usually we have enough for about half of the group, but we are shorthanded with them tonight. So I have two, so if anyone wants, you guys are more than welcome, and if anyone else wants to turn, please make sure to pass them on. There's a nurse that used to work here, and she didn't die here, actually, but they say spirits have a tendency of going back to places that they have familiarity with, places that bring them comfort, workplaces, family homes, etc. And so we have caught her voice in here as well. And there's another spirit that hangs out in here, and we don't even know who this one is. And it actually hangs out in that back room right there in the corner. A lot of people, we've had reports of people on our tours with us in this room that have reported their hips being grabbed, their butts being grabbed, people with book bags or purses getting tugged on, you know, things like that.
Ears blown in.
Before you guys all walked in, me and her did a little EVP session. If you guys want to hear it.
If you guys want, come in a little bit closer so everyone can hear this.
Everybody
move on in.
I think, what did they ask? Happy birthday.
Yeah.
I'm going to play it.
Quiet, please.
I'll play it back one more time.
We're going to be doing some EVP sessions. We got to be quiet.
I'll play it one more time.
Happy.
I'm going to play. Did you hear?
Yeah.
There's I have a little girl coming in, and it's her birthday, and then he says something.
Happy birthday. He said happy birthday.
Like this. Happy birthday.
Wow.
Wow.
I even think he says little girl, too.
Since you guys are all quiet, we'll do a little session.
Yeah,
right
and we have to ask that we have absolute pure quietness. If you have your ringers on your cell phone off, please turn them off. Please keep from moving shuffling. Your jackets around because it'll pick up on that. Please don't shuffle your feet. With this particular device, it's called an EVP recorder. It only records sound if it hears anything. Now, when we play it back, when we ask questions, and if you hear that the question, because we normally give about 15, 20 seconds in between each question, so whatever is here, spirit is here, has time to respond. And when we play it back, if you hear that the questions are coming back one by one right away, that means that there is nothing picked up in between those questions. So
no whispering.
Yeah, no whispering or anything. If anyone has any questions that you want to ask, feel free to ask. One of us will point to you when we feel you get that at least 15, 20 seconds in between. And if you're in the back and want to ask a question, please make sure that you are pretty loud with it so that the EVP detector can get it. Sorry.
Raise your hand if you want to ask a question, and we'll just point to you and then just ask the question.
So I'm going to start off with my question okay. That Avery wants me to ask.
Okay, here we go. On the count of three. One, two, three.
Spirits, if there's any in here, can you please let us know you're here and show yourself? Avery wants to see you.
Can you say happy birthday for her through this device?
What year is it?
Can you tell us the name of this place? I don't think I really heard anything there, so. Want to do another one?
Let's do a spirit box since you got it warmed up.
Yeah, that thing's cool.
Yeah, that thing we get automatic responses with on the spot. I love this thing.
Hold on a moment. It's
fun for it. It's trying to set.
How many spirits are in here with us right now?
Can you say hello to everyone that's here, please? Half Naked Greg, are you in here with us tonight?
Where?
Are you upset Colleen's not here? Is that why you're not talking to us?
Tell us the name of this place through this device. Did you say the F word?
Yeah.
You guys hear the F word?
Yeah.
This is good.
Are we disturbing you? Do you not like us in here tonight? Is that why you're swearing at us?
Rikers Island?
We heard the rioting through the spirit box earlier. Can you do that again?
Nope.
You guys were screaming.
You said that you burned it all. What did you burn? There's been multiple fires here. Can you tell us which one you're talking about? Are you talking about the fire that had killed the warden's wife, Odette?
Not anything like that. What about it, sir?
riot fires, maybe the fires that burn down the buildings that we call the burn district, is that what you're talking about?
It was in the stairwell to the south, to the north actually.
Uh-oh.
Hey, I see you there.
You just...
You decide. I don't decide. You tell me who you are. Why are you hiding in the stairwell?
She said she needed to say wife.
It said what?
Are you talking about Odette? The warden's wife?
First one. It was
I heard Odette.
You.
That's you.
That's you again.
That's you. All right, spirits, we're going to let you go. Thanks for talking to us. We appreciate you communicating with us. We're going to say goodbye.
So I hope you enjoyed this little tour of Joliet. It's actually the next day here, and I'm just got done editing the video, and I noticed that I had a lot of editing errors, not by me, but by the software, which is kind of odd, because I've never had this issue before. So I would go make cuts, and I couldn't make the cuts. So I had to go back in and out a few times to edit this video. So it's kind of odd. Like I said, never had that happen before. So I don't know if it had something to do with what I was filming last night. It's hard to tell. But I want to thank you for watching. Be sure to like and subscribe. And I'll see you later and down the road.